Well, welcome to Fresh Start. We're so glad to be with all of you together. It might be a little chilly outside, but hopefully it's nice and warm in your home with whatever warm beverage you have in hand. We have a couple of announcements right at the start while we get things going. First, you may be missing our coffee hour that we usually had after Fresh Start or after the 10 o'clock service. And so today at 11:30, there will be a virtual coffee hour. Information was sent to you in the Kingsway Lambton e-blast this past week, and it's called Lobby. So if anyone wants to join, there are steps of instructions to help walk you through that process. It's very easy to do, and it's a great way to just get in small group conversation, get reconnected with folks. We did a trial run of it last week and it was really lovely. So I would love for you to join if you're ready for a second cup of coffee at 11:30. That would be a wonderful way for us all to stay connected. If you have any problem finding that information in your email, you can go ahead and shoot me an email this morning and I'll make sure to get that sent out to you. Second, just to remind you, we have our virtual pageant that is happening on December 2nd at 6:30 p.m. You may have heard smatterings about this over the past months. You may have even seen snippets of our stars as they were filming out at church and in the surrounding areas. But we've had over 50 children who have been involved in our Christmas pageant, and truly, it is so exciting. And many thanks to Donna Lee and to a number of volunteers who I know I'm forgetting right now, who have pulled this together, especially Ian Grundy for his musical wizardry, combining so many voices. So this is truly a pageant that you don't want to miss. So I hope you'll tune in on Wednesday, December 2nd at 6:30. And Judy, if you would unmute and then share an update on the Warmth Initiative.
Thank you, Leanne. Well, it's been a very busy week. A lot was accomplished by a few small and mighty teams of people. There's a limit of only six people in the church at a time, so work had to be done with small groups, but there was lots of stuff that we dealt with. I want to just mention some of the people that were critical on those work teams that are Fresh Start or church people. Of course, Don Lee is my partner in crime, and so we did a lot of stuff together, but also Jeff Loudon and Colleen Coleman were right there sorting. Mark Pace, maybe they're too tired to be with us this morning, actually, after all the work they did. The Mayhew family, and yesterday, Karen, where is she? Oh, there she is. Karen was right there doing a hygiene kit. So lots of people helped. At the end of the weekend, we had made 500 hygiene kits, which was our goal. And each of them had 8, 10, some even had more than that items in them. So these are going to be really great for the homeless people. And believe it or not, this year we collected the teens and then people coming to the Warmth Initiative over 600 pairs of socks, and then several items of warmth, coats, scarves, mittens, hats. Several hundred of those. I don't have the exact count on that right now. And also, so far, the people who are sewing toques, the fleece toques, they have delivered 700. So over the next few days, the items I've just mentioned will all be delivered out to seven different, or five different charities, and Fred Victor Loft, the two outreach charities, Youth Without Shelter in Stonegate, and Connect Ministry. So I'll tell you more next week about how those deliveries went and all the wonderful volunteers I have that are going to take those deliveries out and take them to all the different spots around the city, and more about how the Toque Project will continue. But thanks to everybody here who donated, because we just got, you wouldn't believe the piles. We got a lot of stuff, so it was great. Thank you.
Thanks, Judy. And thanks to all who have been involved in that, who have solicited donations from friends and neighbors. I especially want to point out the few teens who have led our sock drive initiative for the last 3 years, Ethan Corley, Adam and Nathan Whale. Their passion and excitement for that project has been really, really fun to get to go along with them for the ride. So thank you to everyone who is participating in the work and the ministry that God has called Kingsway Lambton into. It's so neat to see how that fans out in so many different ways. Well, as we come together in worship this morning, hear these words of Jesus: "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Let's pray. God of every good gift, we come to worship today seeking many things. Some of us are seeking peace. Some are seeking healing. Some are seeking answers. And others are looking for the right questions. We trust that you will give us what we need, food for our deepest hunger. In Jesus' name, amen. Our first song this morning is called Bread of Life, Feed My Soul, and it's being sung by Nathan Gritter of our Kingsway Lambton Choir and arranged by Ian Grundy. Let us join our hearts and maybe even our voices, if you feel comfortable singing at home, in worship this morning.
Bread of life, feed my soul, as the presence of the Spirit makes me whole. Bread of life, fill my heart with the grace and mercy you impart. I have heard your voice calling, come my friend and see. The feast that is laid out for you to show how much I care. Bread of life, help me live a life as pure and true as Jesus did. Bread of life, help me see the boundless love of Christ for you. I have heard your voice calling, come my friend and see, in the feast that is laid out for you, to show how much I care. Bread of life, feed my soul, as the presence of the Spirit makes me whole. Bread of life, fill my heart, grace and mercy.
And now Larry Smith has our scripture reading this morning from the Gospel of Luke.
Thanks, Leanne. It's Luke 9, 1 to 9 and 12 to 17. Then Jesus called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. He said to them, take nothing for your journey, no staff, nor bag, nor bread, nor money, not even an extra tunic. Whatever house you enter, stay there and leave from there. And wherever you do not, where they do not welcome you, as you are leaving that town, shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. They departed and went through the villages, bringing the good news and curing diseases everywhere. Now Herod the ruler heard about all that had taken place, and he was perplexed, because it was said by some that John had been raised from the dead, by some that Elijah had appeared, and by others that one of the ancient prophets had arisen. And Herod said, John I beheaded, but who is this about whom I hear such things? And he tried to see him. The day was dawning to a close, and the 12 came to him and said, send the crowd away so that they may go into the surrounding villages and countryside to lodge and get provisions, for we are here in a deserted place. But he said to them, you give them something to eat. And they said, we have no more than 5 loaves and 2 fish, unless we are to go and buy food for all these people. For there are about 5,000 men. And he said to his disciples, make them sit down in groups of about 50 each. So they did, and made them all sit down. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed them, and broke them, and gave them to the disciples to set before the crowd. And all ate and were filled. What was left over was gathered up, 12 baskets of broken pieces.
Thank you, Larry. May God bless the reading of God's word to our hearing and to our understanding. And we welcome Paul Wilson back again this morning, one of our good friends, to Fresh Start for our sermon.
Well, thank you very much, Leanne. And it's a real pleasure to be with you all again. And as we begin this new lockdown, I think it's important for us to depend on God even more than we have in our own daily lives. It's surprising in this lesson from Luke that Jesus has just appointed his 12 apostles, and now he's sending them out to do their ministry, and he sends them out to the various towns and villages, instructing them to take nothing. Now, they've heard him preach and they've seen him do miracles, and now they are to go out in his name and do the same. They are to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. But as Jesus says, they are to take nothing for your journey. No staff, no bag, nor bread, nor money, not even an extra tunic. All he gives them is his power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. Now, when he says, take nothing for your journey, he really means it. He means nothing. If we were in Jesus' place, we would be telling them, giving them quite different instructions. Some of us have sent our kids off to university, and we know all the things that we've sent them with. But we'd be telling the disciples to, you know, take a sleeping bag and a change of clothes, a raincoat and a sweater, a toothbrush and a towel, food and a credit card. But Jesus forbids it. Take nothing for your journey. And they're going to be staying in people's homes. And we might give them advice to say, well, you know, don't take the first invitation. Make sure you wait and check them out and get the best one. But Jesus says no. Jesus says they are to do no planning about where they will stay. Whatever house you enter, he says, stay there and leave from there. Whenever they do not welcome you, as you are leaving that town, shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. When they return from their journey, from their mission, they are once again with Jesus. They have been listening to him teach 5,000 people out in the wilderness. It's evening, supper time, and they want Jesus to let the people go or else to send them into the villages and get some food. And Jesus tells them to feed the people. They have nothing, or next to nothing. They've got 5 loaves and 2 fish among them for 5,000 people. Once again, they're asked to do their ministry with nothing. Well, in this pandemic, nothing can be a recipe for disaster. Some pastors wanted to do nothing and told their congregations that they didn't have to make any preparations for masks or social distancing. They'd just go on worshiping, and often to tragic effect. A conference in Boston last February was discovered. There were 200 people at the conference, and it was discovered that they spread the virus to 20,000 people. It's not just doing nothing, having nothing. Having nothing can be a terrible experience. This Thursday is Thanksgiving Day in the United States. And when we look south of the border, you've probably seen on the news, long lines of cars waiting for food, miles long, just waiting for free food to be handed out because they don't those folks don't know how they're going to pay their bills. It's no wonder that so many of those people were voting for Trump. They have next to nothing. They're worried about how they will pay the bills and whether they will be able to feed their children. And they don't trust the system anymore. And so someone like Trump seems to maybe be an answer to that. When we have nothing, life can seem pretty much beyond our ability to control it. Well, Jesus, in this lesson, he's not romanticizing about having nothing. There's nothing good about having nothing if it leads to human suffering. But he's not telling them to have nothing. He's telling his disciples to take nothing for their ministry. And how did that turn out for them? Well, we're told that the initial 12 brought good news and cured diseases everywhere they went, and they came back and they were celebrating. And when they return, they're again with Jesus. 5,000 are gathered to hear the teaching about the kingdom of God. And once again, they're faced with an impossible mission. Apparently, they haven't yet learned that nothing can be enough with Jesus. You give them something to eat, he tells them. They've got 5 loaves and 2 fish. So he tells them to seat the groups, the 5,000 in groups of 50, 100 groups of 50, and he takes the 5 loaves and 2 fish and he looks up to heaven. And he blesses and breaks the bread. And he gives it to the disciples to hand out. Now you do the math. 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's probably like about a 50th of 1 slice per person. 1/50th. And a little smidge of fish. I think we've all had sandwiches where we wish there was just a little bit more in the filling. But these, you know, those sandwiches that we've wished about, those are submarine sandwiches compared to what the disciples are giving each member of the crowd there. And once again, the disciples discover that the nothing they started with is more than enough for what they are called to do in Jesus' name. The more they distribute, the more there is. The text says all 8. All 5,000 ate, but that isn't the miracle. The miracle is, let me just say why it isn't the miracle. It's not the miracle because you can give somebody just a crumb of bread and say that everyone ate. The miracle is this: all ate and were filled, it says. All ate and were filled. And what was left over was gathered up, 12 baskets of broken pieces. Jesus fed the people with the word all day, and now he feeds their bodies, and no one goes away hungry. Maybe that's what Jesus is getting at when he sent out the apostles in the first place. When he said, take nothing with you, he intends them to depend totally on God for all of their needs. All he sent them with is, as the text says, his power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases, to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. Now that's interesting. It's as though he says to them, I'm sending you with everything that you need for your ministry. By taking nothing other than the power of the Holy Spirit, they will learn that it is by God's power that they do their ministry. It's by God's power that they will have success. The next to nothing that they think they have to offer is not enough on its own, but God will provide them with whatever else is needed: food, shelter, safety, words to say, the power to heal, the power to care for those they meet along the way. Well, more than that, I think Jesus frees them from concern about having enough. We may all be concerned about not having enough of this or that. Jesus says, don't worry about it. Don't even think about it. Because when you are serving me, you will have enough. Serve God to people. That's what he's telling us. Serve God to people. There isn't one of us who can't serve God to people. Even trapped in your home, or you can serve those in the house with you, or online with you, or at the other end of the phone. Every time we take what little that we have, whether it's physical, like food or clothing or money, or whether it's emotional and spiritual, like joy, love, forgiveness, understanding, whatever it is that is needed by those around us, no matter how little we have to give of it, it can be enough in service to God. Whatever we do in Jesus' name, God makes our nothing into more than enough. God takes what little we have and multiplies it and magnifies it and glorifies it in his name enough to feed 5,000 people. And that's what we're to do. Feed God to people. What if it's true that God makes our nothing into more than enough? A colleague of mine in ministry was called late at night after a long day at the church and meetings into the evening. She was called late at night to come to visit a couple in the hospital. Their son had been involved in a bad accident and was in emergency. And she felt that she had to go to them, but she felt that she had nothing to give to them. She rushed about the house and gathered what she needed and grabbed her Bible, and all the way to the hospital, she prayed. She prayed, God, let me give them something that they need. Provide me with what I need to give them. Well, she went in and she stayed with that family through the night and into the next afternoon when the son's condition stabilized and the crisis passed. She said, I went into that room where they were with nothing. But as soon as I saw them, it was as though Christ was already there in that room, and I had no sense of being tired or helpless. The more love I gave, the more I felt I had to give. The more love she gave, the more she felt Christ's presence in the room with them. So we don't have to worry about how much we have. When we're doing ministry for others, just the little that we have is enough. God became nothing for us in coming to us as a child at Christmas. Became human and totally vulnerable to the human condition and everything that we suffer. And Jesus became nothing for us in dying on the cross and turned that nothingness into the fullness of life for anyone who wants it. So trust that the nothing that you have to give to others on this day is more than enough for you to serve God to those around you. May it be so.
Amen. Thank you, Paul. This is the time in our service where you get to talk back. So I hope you have found where your mute button lies so you can unmute it. Paul had passed along some questions to me that we might think about for our discussion today. And like always, I'll put them in the chat. But they are, how can I minister to others if I feel I have nothing to give? When we reach out to others, are we only offering ourselves or something more? Do we do what we do on our own in loving God and neighbor? And so I'm going to post those in the chat right now. And I would welcome you to, for whoever would like to respond to the sermon, to any of those questions, to go ahead and unmute and jump in. Well, thank you everyone for this rich discussion. This is always the highlight of the service for me. So I love getting to hear how the Spirit is speaking to all of us and how we are responding to God. Our next song is You Raise Me Up, you might possibly know it, by Brendan Graham and Rolf Lovland. And it's sung here by the Kingsway Lambton Choir and arranged by Ian Grundy. Let us pray together. O gracious God, who sees us and feeds us, you remind us again and again that you are present with your people, that when our hearts are broken, you are here. When we wait and worry about a diagnosis, when we lose the ones we love, where anyone is hungry or thirsty, you are here. when we feel like strangers or where anyone is sick or in need of care and company, you are here. When people are in prison, when anyone needs clothing, you are here. Loving God, you are here with us when we suffer. Empower us to also be with others as they suffer, as they hunger, our neighbors both near and far. God, in the midst of our world's deepest hunger, we pray that you might bless our nothing, that in your grace and in your love, we would be filled to remember that our nothing is enough in Jesus. God, we pray that you would help us to look for you in the face of our neighbor, and that in caring for others, we would discover the joy and the glory of being part of the feast. God, for all the heavy concerns in our hearts and in our minds, we pray for your peace. In Jesus' name, amen. I wanted to share this benediction with you that comes from the words of Teresa of Avila. She says, "Christ has no body now on earth but yours, no hands but yours, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes through which the compassion of Christ looks out on the world. Yours are the feet with which he is about doing good. Yours are the hands with which God blesses God's people." So friends, as we go from this place in the power of the Holy Spirit, may you go filled with God's love so that you might serve others and find that your nothing is more than enough in Jesus. Amen.